Good morning. The first item of business this morning is general questions. And as ever, I would appreciate succinct questions and answers to allow as many members to get in as possible. And at question number one, I call Daniel Johnson.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the ADHD medication shortages as referred to in the National Patient Safety Alert of the 27th of September.
Minister Jenny Minto.
Thank you. It is anticipated that the global shortage of medicines used to treat ADHD will be resolved by the end of December. The shortages are caused by a combination of manufacturing issues and increase in demand. The pricing and supply of medicines is a reserved matter for the UK Government, and we continue to engage with them. The Scottish Government recognises the impact of these global shortages on people living with ADHD and their families. NHS Scotland has robust systems in place to manage medicine shortages when they arise. Anyone affected by this issue should speak to their clinical team.
Daniel Johnson.
I thank the Minister for that answer. I remind the Chamber of my own diagnosis and the fact that I take medication for my ADHD. This is a situation that has caused a huge amount of anxiety. A diagnosis and medication is what brings order to what has previously been chaotic and troubled lives for many. And while it's good to hear that the Minister expects the situation to resolve itself in December, first of all, can I ask, what clarity does she have? But critically, what practical information is being given to people? Because I don't know whether or not I should be ordering more medication or not, because there's also advice not to stockpile. But most critically, for people on Lisdex amphetamine, there are serious medical consequences if people suddenly stop taking the medication. So have they been written to, and is medical supervision and assistance being provided to those people on Lisdex amphetamine?
Thank you, Minister.
I thank Daniel Johnson for his question, and I absolutely appreciate the impact that this situation is having on individuals and their families who require this medicine. I spoke with my officials yesterday to confirm the time frame, and that is the time frame that they confirmed. And in November, the Scottish Government held an extraordinary meeting of CAMHS lead clinicians and more widely across health boards to share approaches that they were taking within that group. And they agreed continuing collective discussions on managing the shortage and how to communicate effectively with patients.
Supplementary, Stephanie Callaghan.
Presiding Officer, one of my constituents recently reached out really fearful that she'll no longer be able to access ADHD medication for her son. And as we've heard from a colleague, life can be extremely difficult, and it's critical that patients receive regular updates so that they can plan ahead and navigate this difficult time. So with that in mind, can I ask, are there any other steps that the Scottish Government can take to help keep families informed of progress towards resolving this shortage?
Minister.
I thank Stephanie Callaghan for her question, and to reiterate, absolutely appreciate these medicine shortages are very concerning for patients who are affected and their families. As I said in response to Daniel Johnson, in November the Scottish Government held an extraordinary meeting of CAMHS lead clinicians to discuss a collective approach to the shortage of ADHD medication. And NHS boards shared at that meeting the approaches that they were taking, and the group agreed to continue collective discussions. The Scottish Government will continue to keep close dialogue with all health boards to manage the shortage and provide support when needed.
Supplementary, Willie Rennie.
Has the Minister got a handle on two things? Once there are reports that assessments have ceased in some parts of the country, is that happening? How much is it happening, and what's she doing about it? Secondly, some people have been put onto alternative medicines, but they've not been nearly as effective. Has the Minister got a handle on that as well? Does she understand the full position?
Minister.
So I thank Willie Rennie for his question. I had not been informed of the first part of your question, and will chase that up with officials. As I understand it, any decision to change medication will be a clinical one and will be done on a one-to-one basis, but happy to check again that question as well.
Question number two, Ruth McGuire.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its plans for a human rights bill.
Minister Emma Roddick.
The Scottish Government will introduce a new human rights bill before the end of the parliamentary year. The bill's consultation concluded in October, receiving almost 400 responses, and I'm grateful to those who responded and look forward to continued engagement on the bill as it's drafted. The bill will incorporate more of our internationally recognised human rights into Scots law, a task given greater urgency by the UN Special Rapporteur on Extreme Poverty, who last week accused the UK government of breaching its international obligations with regards to fundamental economic and social rights.
Ruth McGuire.
Thank the Minister for that answer. Equal rights between men and women is a fundamental principle of the UN. Men's violence against women and girls is both a cause and a manifestation of inequality. CEDAW is unequivocal. Trafficking and prostitution are issues states must address if they're to eliminate discrimination against women. How will the Scottish Government's incorporation of human rights charters into Scots law assist women who are subject to this violence and inequality?
Minister.
The Scottish Government is committed to eliminating all forms of violence against women, and that is why the bill will break ground for women in Scotland by incorporating CEDAW into Scots law alongside three other UN treaties. Incorporating four international treaties is a complex and technical endeavour, and we want to deliver a clear and accessible bill. To navigate these complexities, ministers are considering applying a procedural duty to certain rights in the bill, including those which relate to CEDAW. That would mean that public authorities will have to consider the protections the treaty gives women in areas like health and family life when delivering services like housing or education, and can be held accountable if they do not.
Question number three, Graham Simpson.
To ask the Scottish Government what plans it has to carry out its commitment to put community audiology services on a par with free community eye care services.
Minister Jenny Minto.
Thank you. The Scottish Government remains fully committed to enhancing community audiology services. We are continuing to work closely with NHS boards, social care and third sector to develop fully integrated and sustainable audiology services located closer to the local communities being served. Our approach will be informed by the outcomes from the recently published National Audiology Review.
Graham Simpson.
Well, can I thank the Minister for that answer? The independent review of audiology services in Scotland, which I assume is what the Minister was referring to, noted that, quotes, there are many areas ripe for improvement and there is a huge appetite for change, and it found multiple systemic problems within audiology services in NHS Scotland. So will the Minister set out a timeline for such improvement?
Minister.
I thank Mr Simpson for his question. I too welcome the publication of the independent review of audiology services, and we are now considering the recommendations very carefully. We are clear that this review is an opportunity to refocus audiology services in Scotland, to learn from mistakes that have been made and to shape a better future for audiology as a whole. We will provide an update to Parliament in due course, but in the meantime, and in response to the concerns highlighted by the independent review, the Scottish Government has provided additional funding to health boards to support further training in auditory brainstem response assessments for staff working in paediatric audiology services.
Question number four, Liz Smith.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it's had with Transport Scotland about motorway gantry signage ahead of winter.
Minister Fiona Hislop.
Traffic Scotland is a service provided by Transport Scotland to make sure journeys on Scotland's roads are as safe and as smooth as possible by gathering real-time information on Scotland's trunk road and motorway network. This information is then shared with road users on a number of platforms, including overhead gantry signs to reduce the disruption caused by trunk road closures, congestion, events, roadworks, adverse weather, accidents and other incidents. And when the gantry signs are not being used for these higher priority messages, there are two sets of background safety messages displayed, which change to coincide with summer traffic and winter traffic, and these messages are reviewed annually by Traffic Scotland. During the recent storms, the motorway gantry signs were utilised to inform the public of severe weather warnings, and all of this was discussed at the winter service launch that I attended recently.
Liz Smith.
Thank you. I'm asking this question because I've had representation from Mid Scotland and Fife constituents that there are frequent instances when gantry signs are not displaying the time-sensitive information. Just one example, which I happen to say I've seen for myself on several occasions, is the three M90 gantry signs on the south side of the Queen's Ferry crossing, which between 9:30, 10 o'clock-ish, are telling motorists that there are queues at Hermiston Gate and on the city bypass when that is actually not correct. I probably was correct an hour before. But can I ask the Cabinet Secretary if we can do something about the time-sensitive information, because it's very important for the decisions that motorists make?
Minister.
I think it's an important point made by our constituents. I'm sure the MSP will be aware that this is an operational matter for Transport Scotland and for Traffic Scotland, but I'm happy to relay her concerns to them, but she, of course, can write directly to them as an operational matter.
Question number 5, Finlay Carson.
To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on the role that peatland plays in climate change mitigation and adaptation.
Minister Gillian Barton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government's position is that peatlands play a critical role in mitigating and adapting to the climate and nature emergencies. Peatlands are essential in our journey to net zero and increasing our resilience to a challenging climate. Around 75% of our peatlands have been degraded through drainage, extraction, overgrazing, afforestation and development. And we have invested £250 million to restoration and we're dedicated to achieving our targets in this regard. We're working with partners and stakeholders to ensure that our peatlands continue to contribute to our climate goals while supporting biodiversity and sustainable land management.
Finlay Carson.
Thank the Minister for that response. Currently, my constituents in Galloway are once again facing a tidal wave of new wind farm applications in an area which has already a disproportionate high number of existing wind turbines and many more approved awaiting construction. Potential sites north of Newton Stewart will inevitably result in disturbance of peatland and in turn have a significant impact on the water levels in the River Cree and the Penkiln Burns. Newton Stewart and Minnegaff suffered serious flooding in 2015 with many homes lost and businesses now only recovering. So while renewable energy is important, the Minister set out equally important is peatland preservation and restoration. So can the Minister give my communities an assurance that peatland and its role in flood protection will be given a priority over inappropriately sited wind farms?
Minister.
Carson, for that question. Work is currently underway to assess the operation of and, if necessary, update replace the carbon calculator. The Scottish Government will ensure that adequate tools and guidance are available to inform the assessment of net carbon impacts and the development proposals in peatlands and other rich carbon soils. But I am delighted to hear that Finlay Carson recognises the importance of restoring and protecting peatland. He'll be very keenly aware that in the Wildlife Management and Muirburn Bill, we're proposing licensing around Muirburn and peatland. And I hope his interest in this signals that the Conservatives will support the Government's bill, which will limit the destructive burning on peatland as well, for all the reasons that he identifies.
And supplementary, Mercedes Vialba.
Nature Scots Peatland Action Programme grants funding to landowners to carry out peatland restoration, often by hiring private contractors. This means less scrutiny over working conditions, value for money and environmental impacts. Why is the Scottish Government outsourcing peatland restoration rather than investing in democratically accountable, unionised public sector jobs?
Minister.
I would say to Mercedes Vialba, if she has got any concrete evidence of instances where she is concerned about working practices involving peatland restoration, I would be happy to look at that if she wants to write to me.
Minister. Apologies. We move to question number 6, Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it will publish a delivery plan for improvements to the A75 and A77 trunk roads.
Minister Fiona Hislop.
The SBR2 delivery plan is currently in preparation and will contain details for future improvements on both the A75 and the A77. This Government is already delivering improvements to both roads. This year alone, we will deliver over £3 million worth of vital structural maintenance on the A75 and resurfacing works worth £1.4 million on the A77. On the A75 specifically, we have been in discussion with the UK Government for over a year now since they set out what they wanted to fund, that they wanted to fund aspects of the A75 improvement work through the UK-wide connectivity funding, but no funding has actually been delivered yet by the UK Government for improvements on the A75. That clarity on funding is key to determine timelines and plans for these projects.
Colin Smith.
Thank you, President Officer. I hear what the Minister says about discussions with the UK Government over the A75, but ultimately the commitments on both trunk roads were made by the Scottish Government in its strategic transport review. And of course, the A77 doesn't feature at all in the UK Government's connectivity review. Does the Minister accept there is real frustration in the community and from businesses like the ferry firms in Cairn Ryan that we don't have a clear timeline and a commitment to funding for those promised improvements either to those trunk roads? And will she agree to meet with a cross-party delegation of MSPs and representatives of the local campaign groups to hear from them just why improving these vital road links are so crucial to the economy of the southwest of Scotland.
Yeah. Minister.
I've already heard on a number of occasion representations, particularly by industry, and I think his points about Karen Ryan are well made. And if Diary permits, certainly I would be interested to meet with those campaigners. However, I would reiterate that the interests I've heard so far have said that they really want action on the realignment of the Springholme and Crocketford pieces of work. That's the piece of work that we understand the UK government want to help fund in terms of those issues to make sure that they can go forward. There are other areas that we have been supporting and funding, and not least on the A77. There have been six maintenance programmes over the financial year alone. And indeed, as I've said to many members who've asked this question, remember the Maybole bypass was delivered by this government and has made a big difference to people using the A77.
And supplementary, Sharon Dunn.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The A77 is a key road for businesses and thousands of local people who rely on it to commute to work and visit family and friends. The number of accidents on it is very concerning. Public safety is at risk and we need to see action. Will the SNP government invest to improve this vital route, or does it plan to cut the budget for roads again next year?
Minister.
So I refer the member to my answer where I talked about particularly the Maybole bypass. There's also been the Symington and Bog End toll work, the Park End to Benane, Glen App wide single carriageway, the Hagstone climbing lane, and also this year with the £1.4 million that have been invested this year. That's the Kirkcaldy South Gateway, the south of Turnberry, north of Turnberry, Turnberry and Treeswood Head Road. That investment continues. We're committed to supporting people that use the A77 and the A75.
Question number 7, Keith Brown.
To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the potential impact of UK Government migration policy on Scotland's economy and workforce.
Cabinet Secretary Neil Creagh.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The UK Government's immigration system does not meet Scotland's distinctive needs, as Scotland's population story differs from elsewhere in the UK. All sectors of the Scottish economy are experiencing labour shortages as a direct consequence of Brexit and the ending of free movement across Europe. The National Strategy for Economic Transformation Skilled Workforce Programme set out actions that we are taking forward to work with employers to address labour and skills gaps, and our recently published paper Migration in an Independent Scotland sets out proposals to introduce a welcoming immigration system that will increase our working age population and address our skills shortages.
Keith Brown.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer? He may know that at a recent meeting of the SEAC Committee of this Parliament, Professor Paquan of the Quebec National School for Public Administration confirmed that arrangements in Canada allow the Quebec National Assembly to make decisions over economic immigration which meet their specific needs, and this has produced substantial economic benefits for Quebec and for Canada. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that similar powers for the Scottish Parliament would allow us to address the issues that we face under current UK government policy, such as the declining population and skill shortages that the Cabinet Secretary mentions? And in the absence of the reform of the immigration system, only independence offers the opportunity to fully implement our own distinct system tailored to the needs of the people of Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
Absolutely, yes. Keith Brown makes a very salient point. This government has consistently argued for the devolution of migration powers to this Parliament, which the UK government have blatantly ignored. The UK government's migration system is not designed to meet our needs. It is having a damaging effect on Scotland's economy and communities. And Scotland has distinctive needs. Our population story differs from the rest of the UK. I agree that only with independence and with the full powers of migration could Scotland have the opportunity to devise a humane, principled approach to migration that is needs-based and delivers positive outcomes for our communities, public services and economy, rather than one that tries to send people to Rwanda contrary to the view of the courts.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes general questions, and there will be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business. Thank you.